Good evening, Trinidad and Tobago. Today, we are going to discuss the correct way to climb downstairs. To the PNN trolls who all over Facebook telling people to have some compassion. Where's your compassion for the mothers and the children and the fathers and the brothers and the sisters stuck in those same hospitals that Stuarty passed through like a breeze today? Where's your compassion for them? One of our members, a deputy political leader of the Progressive Empowerment Party, Lima McLeod Wilkinson, she called me about a year ago. She was in Mount Hope Hospital. Her daughter had broken her hand. Her daughter had broken her hand and she was in the hospital for over 10 hours. And she only reached out to me because she was, I just telling somebody doing a live video now. She, somebody from Manzanilla, Cassandra, who reached out, she messaged me to ask if we only a party in the West. You see, this is what the media doing, eh? Because we were in Mayaro. But Mayaro is not Manzanilla, man. Manzanilla is before Mayaro. Anyway, these same trolls and these same sycophants, they don't have any compassion for people like Lima, whose daughter, 10 years old, sat with a broken hand or arm in Mount Hope. I had to call doctors all over the place. I said, but this is madness. Give me a link. Help me get somebody. There is a little child with a broken bone sitting in Mount Hope. And she's not yet seen by a doctor. She's now hungry. She's tired. She's been there for 10 going on 11 hours. Stuart fall down a step and bump his shoulder, and they rush him to hospital. And he passed through like a breeze, and sent out a release, the Reed Stuart release. I'll read it. Paul Daniel Nahus put out a post and say, this is not something to joke about. This is exactly something to joke about. The man ain't dead. He ain't dead. Kamala called for an investigation. Call for an investigation into why the whole blasted country don't work now. Let me talk this. You're in a fire station, surrounded by the brass of the fire services, and the step that you come down on give way and you fall and bounce yourself. Who have the responsibility to certify the stage? Guess who? Fire services. So the whole brass of the fire services watch their collective failure as Stuart Young do a cartwheel down the steps. But wait, UDCOT, Urban Development Company of Trinidad and Tobago, that built it, that put together the stage and the stairs. They may have subcontracted it, but their project manager was responsible for it. Who signed off on that step? Listen, eh? All you don't know me, you know. You see these political trolls who are defending bullshit in this country? It is y'all more than anybody else that are responsible for this nation staying stalled as a failed nation. You see, good people want to get into the politics, but then they have to run up against jackasses like all you. This is not something to laugh about. A fella named Bert Gransall sucking at the PNN teeth. He's a PEA trying to make light of it. Brother, hush. You don't like what I said? Find something else to listen to. Go into cult headquarters in Ballysay House and prostrate yourself in front of the altar of Williams and say, piss more on me, massa. Don't give me no talks. But what I'm making light of, when all you send gorillas to rip the sari off the girl in all your sports day, all you didn't care about that. That was funny. Same jackasses. Miss me with all your bullshit. What y'all didn't think in that cult, what y'all didn't think in that Ballysay cult, is that somebody as strong as me would stand up for the people of Trinidad and Tobago someday. But we're there now. And on the 21st of March, we will begin the rumble of the political war drums. We will, and I have to use the word political, because if I say war drums, they're going to send lawyers. They're going to say Philip talking war. So I have to say political war drums. But Fitzgerald Hines could say, get a stake and find them UNC vampire and press it in their heart and don't stop till they're dead. Fitzgerald Hines could say that. Fitzgerald Hines could say the little Rasta boy who kissed Kamala, he would have cut off his dread, a nasty little Rasta boy. That Fitzgerald Hines. But a man who cuss you about the conditions of the country under you must make jail. All you stink and dirty. But you all never thought that there would be people with my caliber and capacity that would stand up for the people of this country. Make no mistake. March 21st from 5 p.m. March 21st from 5 p.m. The drums of political war begin to beat. The tremor that people suspect coming will begin. There is going to be an election in this country, constitutionally due, September 2020. Kamala T for 6 months, I have no doubt. This man gonna say, President said, we Tiffin 6 months too, no problem. We ready for September, October, November, December, January, February, March. We here. We launching our first 10 candidates on the 21st of March. Ring right round the country. 4 weeks later, come in with 10 more. Call the election. We ready. We ready for the road. And it is time. It is way past time. So to the trolls and the sycophants, Stuarty boy, take a tumble. Don't do like the man fall off a building and bust his head. He take a tumble. He get up holding his shoulder because he know. He look like a clown. Everybody talking. You come from a legacy that's supposed to know how to land. And you have black belt. Nobody felt sorry for Stuart. Nobody. The Guardian had to run and put out an article with the four people who demonstrated something like compassion for the minister. And it wasn't even real compassion. And when you click the link, Guardian, it's going nowhere. Check all yourself. Check all yourself. I wanna find Stuart release. Somebody send it to me, please. No. On WhatsApp or as a private message on Facebook. I want to deconstruct Stuarty. I know I have it all over, you know. I have it all over. Let me find it. All in all, your million message with the stage not good again. All your bad. Trini, all your worthless. The stage not good again. I will say the stage good is the steps that not good again. And if that was karma, Stuart Young, if you wanted my compassion, for a minute, if it mattered to you, when you reach in that hospital, you would have tell them, sit me down where the rest of the trainees sit in, where the citizens, the taxpayers that pay my salary and fund this hospital, where they sit in, sit me there. Whatever is the terms and the conditions and the operations of this hospital for a citizen of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, subject me to that too. I need to feel it. So when I go to the cabinet, I will ask Terence D'Alsing, if I had to take 8 hours to see a doctor, what did we spend $5 billion on this year? $5 billion last year, $5 billion the year before. If the hospital is such a shithole, what did we spend $5 billion every year on? What? Every single one of you. I want to deconstruct Mr. Mann's statement and then I'll read my release. Let's deconstruct it for you. Stuarty, I would like to thank all the well-wishers and persons inquiring as to my well-being. I am fine. All of the persons that was inquiring to Stuart's well-being could fit in a maxi taxi. This morning, after giving my remarks at the opening of the new Pinal Fire Station, as I was coming off the stage and stood on the one step to come off, hear me, this demand release, you know. So he indict the fire service and Unicut and whoever Unicut subcontractor build this stage. This morning, after giving my remarks at the opening of the new Pinal Fire Station, as I was coming off of the stage and stood on the one step to come off, it slid as it was not anchored or secured, and I fell. That sounds like a lawsuit. The fall was quite a hard one, and I dislocated my shoulder. He fell off one step and dislocated his shoulder. If he had fell off three steps, he'd have dead. Stuart Young, you're made of glass. I was rushed by the fire services ambulance to the San Fernando General Hospital. But if it was you and your child, you're still waiting for the ambulance. I was rushed by the fire service ambulance to the San Fernando General Hospital, where I was diagnosed, treated, and discharged for a dislocated shoulder. But if it was you and your mother, or you're still sitting in casualty waiting, trying to find a doctor, I would like to thank all of the people that helped me and treated me during this experience. Stuarty, you tumbled. You didn't discover the cure for cancer. You tumbled, son. You fell off a step. You're not the first. Don't make it sound like you went through the Holocaust or that you spent some of the years with Mandela. You tumbled off a step. I thank the fire services personnel who carried me in the ambulance for their comfort and professionalism. Where were the paramedics? Of all of the nurses, doctors, and other staff at the San Fernando General Hospital who diagnosed and treated me, what did they diagnose you with, Stuart? Bruised ego? I felt proud of the level of treatment and expertise of all of the personnel at San Fernando General Hospital. And I thought, but you never experienced it the way the average person does. So you see, that piece of bullshit, Stuart Young, that piece of self-serving, self-congratulating, government history rewriting bullshit, you could miss us with it. Because while you were whisked through as a VIP, there have been people there that doctors were on shift that saw sitting there, left, come back on shift, and they're still there waiting. So who you need to thank, Stuart? Hear me. Thank the person whose place you took. They skip you in line. That's what they do. That's what they did. They didn't bring fresh doctors in a fresh hospital with fresh beds. They skip you in line. Stuart, if you have an ounce of decency, thank the person whose place you stole. Thank that person. Fortunately, I did not break or fracture any bones or hit my head. God is good. That's two different sentences, brother. That is two different sentences altogether. And I don't think you need to be bringing God into this at all. Yeah? You tumble down one step. But for Trinidad and Tobago, and you have to take this very seriously, because we have an opportunity here not to play like we fake piety. I want to tell you how we support. You know, I find it now after Satish said it. But this was our release. Did the fire service that inspects stages fail to inspect Stuart stage? Did Unicut build it or contract it out? Was there a transparent bid process for the stage? How much did we pay? Who was the project manager for the stage? Who signed off on the final structure? After the fall, how long did the ambulance take to respond to the emergency call? At the San Fernando General Hospital, was Stuart made to take a number and wait his turn, as happens to every other citizen? How long was that wait? The standard 10 to 12 hours? This release hopes to shine a light on what exactly should be the takeaway from this morning's acrobatic mishap. Stuart's fall exposed so perfectly why this is a failed nation. the assemblage of highly paid office holders present, each with responsibility to ensure what happened did not happen, demonstrates conclusively why this nation needs a complete undo and redo. The human part of me felt compassion for Stuart Young as a human, but the activist in me, fighting for a better country for all our people, wanted Stuart, as minister, to endure all the hardships that the average person endures so that he could go back to the cabinet and ask for an accounting of the ambulance budget, the terms and conditions under which the fire service operates, the remit of and oversight for Unicot and all other special purpose companies, the $5 billion spent on the insanity of our healthcare. By giving him special treatment for his bumped shoulder, we dodged yet another opportunity to face the reality of this failing nation and fix it. Right now, 6 hours later, the phalanx of media should be camped outside San Fernando General Hospital, reporting that the minister is still in the waiting room, holding his shoulder and a number, waiting to be attended to by a doctor. I wish for Stuart Young what I wish for everyone in these circumstances. But more than that, I wish now that he has had his experience, that he finally uses the power of office he currently occupies to help the taxpayers who fund all of it get similar or better treatment than he enjoyed today. The investigation that we should all be calling for is why, despite spending upwards of $60 billion a year to operate this country, nothing works as it should in Trinidad and Tobago. Philip Edward Alexander, political leader, the Progressive Empowerment Party. And I would like to add, in closing to that, anybody who demonstrated hair pulling, garment rending, heart pulling, pain, Stuart, if that level of compassion doesn't extend to every single person who's stuck in the hospital system right now, to the grannies lying down on piss-soaked bed, to the cancer patients that they have no cancer tubes for right now, for the people in casualty who are not sure that they're going to receive treatment before sepsis or the break gets worse, sets in, to all the people suffering at the hands of our public health, if you don't have the same amount of compassion for them, you could miss me with your self-serving fake piety and hypocritical bullshit. Hey! There we go!
Check it out, 9 o'clock in the morning. 9 o'clock in the morning. Boy, boy, 9 o'clock in the morning. 9 o'clock in the morning. 9 o'clock on the door. And no food in the pot. Why? There's a flood in the road. 9 o'clock in the day. You can't see your way. Why? Everywhere you turn, crime and more crime. White collar crime, blue collar crime, no collar crime. We running out of time. In the day, no way
better get paid.
Traffic on the highway. Traffic on the highway.
Bills. Bills. Bills and more bills. 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 Bills and more bills.
Nothing to work. Nothing to work. Nothing, nothing, nothing to work.
$3 trillion spent, nothing to show. That's how it goes in a land named Trinbago.
Nothing to work, nothing to work, nothing, 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 nothing to work, nothing to work, nothing, 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 nothing to work.
Public health fail, public works fail, local government fail, central government fail.
Nothing to work, nothing to work, nothing, nothing, nothing to work, nothing to work, nothing to work.
57 years, tears, tears, tears. 57 years, prayers, prayers, prayers.
Nothing to work, nothing to work, nothing, nothing, nothing to work.
No bread in the kitchen, no gas in the car, no water in the pipe. Everybody by the bar. Hole in the pavement, hole in your shoe, hole in your wallet. There's only holes for you.
Nothing to work, nothing to work.
Of this country. We like the things that have no value for us. They add no value to our lives. I deal with a contractor and he's telling me all the time. He said, when you're going to make a decision, check the numbers. Make your decision on the numbers. If the numbers in your favor, go with it. Don't let emotion come into it. The numbers are the things to pay attention to. And in Trinidad and Tobago, I never tire of telling people that it is an absurdity of epic proportions that we have designed deliberately and spent hundreds of millions of dollars to upkeep a water management system that captures the bounty of rainfall in the hills and washes it to the sea. If anything is an example of this country throwing away the candy and eating the wrapper, it is that. Because all of those paved rivers that run through all of those communities that do nothing with the water but dispose of it like we don't need it is a deliberate act of incompetence set up to sell water tanks, water pumps, and bottled water. And if we just redesigned our water management system, we would never flood and we would never have a drought in this country again. Never. You could wet the lawn in Moka Golf Course and you could wet your yard too. You could wash your car and you could have soca party too. Everybody could have the same amount of water 24/7. You wouldn't have to wake up 3 o'clock in the morning when water starts to fall in the tank to go and flush toilets and wash wares and wash clothes so that the water in the tank don't waste. It is an indictment against Basdeo Pande that he does not know that. It is an indictment against Kamala Prasad Bisesa that she does not know that. It is an indictment against Patrick Manning, may he rot in hell for eternity, that he did not know that. It is an indictment against Keith Rowley, that he does not know that. What the Romans knew 2,000 years ago, what the Aztecs knew 5,000 years ago, that the secret to water management is capture, hold, treat, distribute. Water management has been part of the human experience for over 10,000 years. Learning how to manage the ebb and the flow of water, the tides, learning how to deal with rivers and their flood, learning how to manage those things, took man from Neanderthal and brought us to where we are today. The phone or the computer that you're watching me on, this internet broadcast that is riding on light through fiber optic cables coming to you, none of that would have been possible if man did not learn how to manage water. Because if we did not learn how to manage water, all of society would still be concentrated around rivers and streams and fighting each other over what's going on upstream. We've known this for millennia. We've known this, how to manage water. So what are you saying to me? That Eric Williams was an absolute jackass? Because I want you to understand this, eh? All leadership, all of it, unless you're only leading yourself. From the time you are leading other people, all leadership is man management. All of you watching this video right now, please click share and send this video viral. Let's talk some serious issues to the country. All of leadership is man management. All of it. All of it. Nothing else. That's the job. Man management. Teresa, why are you calling that jackass name on my thread to distract me? Thursday morning, Felicia Holder is going to have on her show farmers, a gentleman that has over 50 acres of aquaculture running. And she will be joined by Akil Camps, who, besides being a member of the executive of the Progressive Empowerment Party and the head of the North Hub, with responsibility for all the constituencies in the North, he is also a successful businessman. He is a contractor, a woodworker, but he is a farming hobbyist. He grows a lot of food. And he will be with her on Thursday morning. We said, this is the Progressive Empowerment Party's position, only the countries that grow their own food will be able to consider themselves independent. We have the ability to be food self-sufficient in a decade, so why is that not the national goal? Is it because 1% food importers are bribing governments to not grow food so that they could continue to make billions importing? What happens when climate change and conflict interrupts crop schedules and shipping? It is time we had conversations about our present and our future. One of the most critical issues is food independence. The Progressive Empowerment Party remains the only political movement in this country disconnected from the 1%, from the contract mafia, from the food importers, the only party talking food security. Our PEP Farms initiative is a proof of concept where consortiums of small farmers and cooperatives are supported by the state during the growth and selling stages. We can feed ourselves, reduce the cost of living, get more food for our money, save foreign exchange, create jobs. So why aren't we doing it? It is time to change the national conversation. I see a new political party crop up and their slogan is, it's time. Well, the PEP have been saying it's time for at least 4 years now. Come back to that. Pradia Larceny. Pradia Larceny, the Pradia Larceny squad is supposed to be the second largest precepted squad in this country after the police service. Pradia Larceny squad. Yet, Pradia Larceny frustrates farmers. Why? Why would Pradia Larceny frustrate farmers? Is it that Pradia Larceny just cannot, it's one of those things, Phil. It's one of those things that you just can't do nothing about. Stick up in writing. It is my position that Pradia Larceny, like everything else that is allowed to happen that frustrates farmers and farming, continues to be allowed because if you frustrate farmers
to get out of farming, you could import more food and make more billions. John Lewis is saying, case in point, the coronavirus as to being self-sufficient. We are about to be hit. Make no mistake, we're not dodging these things anymore. 486 people dead in Italy. Cities are now under curfew, lockdown. This wave is heading this way. Jamaica has its first case. Trinidad and Tobago is not set up to deal with this. This clown car of a government is going to make an intolerable situation that more unbearable. Food self-sufficiency. Since this government, forget Kamala. Kamala who run for election and say that she family make money bundling bhaji and selling bodhi. Egg roll, one bhaji bush. One bundle of bodhi. Not one. But in the 5 years of Kamala, in the 10 years of Kamala and Rowley, we could have had national crops fully harvestable. 4 years. Avocado, mango, guava, breadfruit, soursop as the hardest crops. Those crops, once those trees catch, we feed people for 100 years. And drive the price of food through the ground. But they grow nothing. And they did nothing. They gave land. They gave prime food growing land to friends, financiers, and families to frolic. We have more chain stores. We have more strip malls. We have more cineplexes per capita than any other country in the world. And 90% of them are growing on food, are built on food stock land. Food stock land. Let that sink in. So let's come back to the prairie larceny. First of all, we debunked this bullshit that Keith Rowley put out there that you can't diversify. He meant he can't diversify. But he's a fool. And we are enduring his foolishness for as long as it takes for us to get an election so we could fire him. The diversification of our economy has been the most pressing issue on this country since the global recession of the 80s. Yet, we've kept electing to office people beholding to others other than you. For all your vote, your vote. For all your wee time now, it has never been your time. Never. And those who think that they benefited because they're living in the squalid wonder of a HDC ghetto complex. If you think that is winning, go for a drive in Goodwood Park. The same proceeds of the same state that built Mova, Beetham, Lavantel, and Silots built Goodwood Park, Bayshore, Westmorins, and Glencoe, to name a few. So if you think it was ever your time, take a drive. Food independence. Let's start with the availability of land. We have more land stock than we need to grow all the food that we need to grow. Trinidad and Tobago was a net food exporter up to the 70s. Prairie larceny. All you need to do is certify food sellers. You must be registered. You have to have a number. And anything over 5 pounds of any one item that is sold should come with a license, a receipt that quotes the seller's number and your name. That this seller number sold to John Smith 50 pounds of watermelon. And if you take it home to eat your 50 pounds of watermelon, that is your business. If you set up shop to sell it outside, police are supposed to be able to stop and ask you, where did you get that 50 pounds of watermelon? And you could show them your receipt from a seller so that they could contact that seller and verify the veracity of what you're saying to them. Now, you can't sell that 50 pound of watermelons to another seller because you are not registered as being part of the agriculture community. So that if you sell it to another seller and you registration process is a deterrent. That's bullshit. Come on, Sunil. Sunil, bend over, tie your shoelace, let some blood rush to your brain. Stop talking shit on my chat, man. Registration is an online form. Bim, you're registered. What stupidness you're talking? Registration in Trinidad is a deterrent. But we're not talking about Trinidad under PNM and UNC. We're talking about Trinidad and Tobago under a real progressive government that empowers the people. So don't post nonsense like that on my wall. It's not going to go down good. Going forward, you with your 50-pound watermelon can't sell it to another reseller because you are not registered and you cannot give him a receipt. So if he is out there selling it, and police pull up on him, and he don't have a receipt, he in trouble. You see, you need to be able to protect the food stock. And the fastest way to protect the food stock is to make it a serious, onerous, frightening criminal plan, criminal act to be selling food without a license and a receipt from a registered grower, importer, wholesaler. That way, nobody, because you see what farmers afraid, while they're watching their crop, thieves watching their crop too. And while farmer waiting tomorrow morning and harvesting that, while he's sleeping in the night, people come and harvest the stock. No problem. But you can't sell it. And who buy it must be even more onerous, especially if you are a supermarket or a market or any business that buys food regularly. If you buy produce from someone who cannot give you a receipt in your name showing their registration number, if you buy it from them, you're in trouble. Close you down. Fine you, an onerous fine for encouraging predial larceny. The day we put just that in place, farmers will return to the land and wouldn't need fence and wouldn't need pit bulls running an electric fence to protect their crop. And those costs of security are cost prohibitive and drive the price of food up. Register the farmers, register the wholesalers, register the distributors. Make sure that you can account for this truckload of oranges. You have a truckload of oranges and you selling on the highway. Where you get that from? Boss, I buy this from this fella. He's a wholesaler. Look his number, look my receipt. You go to the wholesaler. Where you get that truckload of oranges from? Boss, I buy it from this farmer. Look my receipt, look his number. And that is how you manage predial larceny. Bring it to a quick and sudden end. The next thing we need to be is a national cooperative. Take back all of our farmland. Take back all of our farmland that is currently growing razor grass, that is currently pushing up strip malls and fast food restaurants. Take it all back and put it to grow food and give it to farmers to work. And if you're a farmer and you want to be a farming entrepreneur, come and talk to the state. Come and talk to the National Food Cooperative, who will be responsible for issuing you access to an acre of land to start. And you have 3 years. And you have a crop that we agree that you will grow based on national consumption data. That national consumption data will be based on growing certain tonnages of different items so that we don't end up with glut or we don't end up with shortage. And we will guarantee you a price for the crop. We are a shareholder in that crop. Our share is going back to the consumer as a discount to the taxpayer who pay our salary so that the country could set up 41 centralized markets, massive markets, so that the people of Paramin and Shagaramus and Carony and Labre and Tobago, anywhere that we grow in food, that the farmers could have access to a massive market, but not just them, to small businesses and restaurant owners, so that the fish farmers, we have people with aquaculture under 50 acres and we want to get them growing more. Lexis Jones, again, you're on the wrong wall. The citizens who don't want to hear about take back land, Those are the ones that don't care about you. I believe that the people of Trinidad and Tobago, when they realize that our plants will cut their food bill, not just in half, and half again, we will make sure that the cost of living in this country come down. You could imagine breadfruit to sell in Trinidad and Tobago for $40. Lexis Jones, that's bullshit. Don't post that on my wall. Trinidadians don't want more stadium for FET. That's what they're settling for because they don't know better. They've never had better. They've had to tolerate that. Anyway, let me not get distracted by them kind of comments. The reality of our situation is a simple one. Our money, the value of the money that we have, doesn't reflect in the cost of living what it should. And a unit of work paid for in Trinidad is not the same, doesn't get you the same value as a unit of work just about anywhere else in the civilized world. Yeah, but Sarah Melissa, Lexis is being sarcastic. He needs to understand it's just passing in front of me as a comment on a live video. So he shouldn't be doing that at this point because I have to be mindful of the people looking on. So if you're being sarcastic, brother, you should write that in the comment. And to anybody else who wants to be sarcastic or cynical in your comment, write that so that I will know that it's not more bullshit because they have so many trolls out there who want to disrupt the conversation that they would say just those same things that you're saying sarcastically, seriously. But anyway, aquaculture, agriculture, food processing, those things don't have to compete with oil, you know. Those things have to compete with food import prices. Those things have to bring the cost of food down for the people. That is job one. Job one. Job two is to get Trinidad and Tobago back to being a net food exporter. So we're playing big on the world market and we could trade and exchange and make sure that our people are well fed. Because that's the job. That's the job. That's the whole job. Make sure that the people are taken care of. That's the job of government. It is not the job to stunt. And Stuart Young, I want to tell you something. That fall down today, that was God, boy, showing y'all, y'all think y'all too high up. Come back down. Come back down. That was a shot across the bow. You're acknowledging God, telling boss, I get what you're trying to say. We pissing down from a height. I realize that the mighty could fall. Noted. Act differently from tomorrow. You must take these messages, you know. You must take these messages to heart. Because if you don't hear it, he will send another message. And the next one might be a little more serious. Might be a little more serious. Yeah? For the UNC trolls that want to come and post, blame Kamala, blame Kamala. Nobody ain't blaming Kamala. Nobody ain't taking Kamala on. For all the 1% contract mafia game about PNM and UNC is the only option, Trinidad and Tobago, no. They have plenty options. They have plenty options. And the Progressive Empowerment Party is going to show 1.4 million people what the power of people power against those who benefit from the power of people power without the people even knowing. We're going to fix this. We're going to fix it properly. We've been made for this moment. We've been set on this mission. Trinidad and Tobago needed rescuing. And this is the rescue. This is an organization of citizens set on fire to rescue 1.4 million people trapped in the insanity of a racist, corrupt political cycle. That is what this is. Long before there was a coronavirus, long before there was a Russia-Saudi Arabia oil price war, there was a PNM. It is the PNM and its outside bastard child, UNC, that has destroyed this country. Don't look to blame coronavirus and the Saudi-Russian oil price war. Don't look to blame them, brother. It is your incompetence and the corruption of government after government that has destroyed this nation and failed it, turned it into the cesspool of a rat hole that it is today. It is that and a bunch of little men and women who have decided to pool their resources at the top to enslave the masters of this country, but that could break. That could break. This Saturday here, we put final pieces in place in 4 meetings happening throughout this country to prepare for the 21st. The Progressive Empowerment Party of Trinidad and Tobago has one mission, one goal, to wake the entire population up to the fact that the well-being of the citizenry is the function and purpose of government. Not a stunt. If you who want to tell me to have compassion for Stuart Young had compassion for the people sitting in traffic every single morning, 4 hours, every evening, 4 hours, I'd consider it. If you tell me that Stuart sat in traffic, that he had to wake up this morning because he had to be in Pinal for 9 o'clock, so he get up at 3 to head down the road. If you tell me that, if you tell me Stuart know how it feel, I could have compassion for Stuart. But don't tell me people who farting through silk and who eating without wondering where the next meal coming from. They have no interest. They're completely detached from the cost of their own existence. People will pick them up, snatch them up, put them in an ambulance, drive them to a hospital, bully everybody else out of the way, attend to him, diagnose, treat him, fluff him, and send him on his way. So he doesn't know. Like Marie Antoinette, when she said, let them eat cake, she was assuming that everybody else had cake when the people ran out of bread. Stuart is disconnected and detached from reality. So his release is bullshit. Thursday morning, Felicia Holder has on her show pep talks in the morning. Farmers. And to all the farmers out there, tune in and call in. And to the farming community of Trinidad and Tobago, stand with the Progressive Empowerment Party. Because generations now have lost. Have lost. Your labor was exploited. You were made promises that you never got. You were told that you were the problem. While people above you, like the dish, ran away with the spoon. Now you have a say. You could tell yourself, I prefer to stay in the cesspool that I know. And that is your right. And I'll respect it. But the Progressive Empowerment Party is betting that there are more people in this country that are capable of understanding that there is another way, a better way. That this country doesn't have to be stunted and stifled, mismanaged and robbed. That it could be operated and managed to the best interests of everybody. It is time. It is way past time. And if you're hearing these words and they're not resonating with you, I want to find something that one of the co-chairs of the Women's Arm put out today, well, a couple days ago, but I got it today. And I couldn't believe how profound Hadassah Charles McLeod wrote. We need to change the way we interpret criticism of the government and not take it personally. Speaking the truth about the state of affairs in our country is not an attack on you. There is no need to defend the government at all costs like it's your child. If you voted for our present administration and you are paying more taxes, more fees, your grocery bill is unexplainably higher, you can't afford a house, you've been affected by the alarming crime rate, you cannot access foreign exchange, you damage your car in a pothole, you're haunted by traffic, you waited a whole day for medical attention at a hospital, you have no water in your taps, etc., etc. If any of these things affect you, then the government has failed you too. It's as simple as that. A hard truth, but maybe it's time to seek representation that delivers, that cares, that will bring change, hope, and opportunity to you and your family. You don't have to continue to get what you've been getting. The change we need is on the other side of your vote. And that is all. And she's correct. Today, somebody from Tranquility School had to put out that the government come and thief piece of the school and fence it to build a political headquarters. So how is that right? How does the state act politically for the PNM and that not be misbehavior in public office? How? You tell me how. You tell me. You explain that to me in a way that makes sense and I will understand because I can understand concepts. Tell me how the political headquarters of the People's National Movement is entitled to seize part of a school at the expense of the children going to school there to build their headquarters. How is that right? How is that reasonable? We, the people of this country, and you see all of you who are abroad, all of you who are abroad, that watching these videos time after time after time, if you've not made a donation yet to this party, then you think I'm an ass. And that's all right. Because I don't mind being an ass till March for the latest. If I'm not in government, I go on too. But if you're abroad and you're watching me and you know that everything that I'm saying is true and you see how hard we're working to try and rescue our country so that you could have something to come back home to and bring your children and say, this is where I grew up. If you're watching that and you've not made a donation yet, then I'm an ass. That's all right. But if you love Trinidad and Tobago and you want to help rescue it, give us some support. We appeal to you because we need your help. We are disconnected from anything that could be giving money with strings attached. We are people that give of our time and our treasure consistently. We have members in New York City, in Toronto, in Florida, in the United Kingdom, who will work to receive and collect, regularly host events, try their very best to organize, to send back, to help with the movement. If you're one of those, please assist. We need the help. Give Anthony Senadan in Toronto, he and the Pep Toronto team, Denise Xavier and the New York team, Rose Fong Chung and Sals Jagasa in Florida, reach out to them, or you could just message Felicia Holder. She's the chairman of the party and she's the chairman of the finance committee, and her number is 769-4590, and we need your help. We need $10, $100, $1,000, $10,000. The show that we're going to put on, the show that we are going to put on right now on the 21st of March, that show is going to cost us tens of thousands of dollars, made possible by the kindness of members. And if what you want is a better country, and you see that the Progressive Empowerment Party is a vehicle for that, then please assist us. Also, and this is important, make sure to tell your friends and your family and everybody in Trinidad and Tobago that they have a responsibility to help rescue this country, to make sure that they registered, and everybody who's a Trinbagonian, to make sure that they registered to come out and vote whenever the election is called, and to forget what the man on the left doing and the man on the right. Don't focus on them. Don't focus on what they're thinking, what they're saying, what they're doing. Focus on you, and you stand up for a better country. And forget about what they're telling you about your vote. You know what you have to do with your vote. Use your vote for a better Trinidad and Tobago. Any other vote is business as usual. Think it through and ask yourself, if for 57 years we've washed the rainwater to the sea so tanks and pumps and bottled water could sell, what will make them change now? They didn't tell you what I tell you. Not one of them ever explained to the people of Trinidad and Tobago that the Diego Martin River alone, if you put retention ponds under the Diego Martin River in the bed of the river, if you did that, Diego Martin could never flood again. And not only that, Diego Martin alone could irrigate the whole country. Not one of those other political parties ever even thought to tell you that. Because as long as tanks and pumps and water bottles selling in Trinidad and Tobago, they get in their donation come election time. We're not connected to the water companies, the tank companies, the pump companies. Think about this country. Think about where you live. Imagine it with no gate. Imagine it with no wrought iron. Imagine opening your window and leaning out. Imagine where you live without water tanks and water pumps. Imagine living without that cycle of tripping on and off that pump when you're on the tank. Imagine living in a country where you don't have to be telling your family, bathe in a bucket, we're on the tank. Imagine not having to worry about water because the government that is responsible for worrying about the water is taking care of business. Imagine each and every one of those rivers interrupted along the path in the beds of the rivers and giant retention ponds sunk in the bed of the river so that rain could be falling bucket a drop in Dago Martin Hills down in West Morins, the river dry because all the water that would normally overflow onto Crystal Stream Highway busy filling retention ponds in the bed of the same river. Imagine that for a minute. Imagine what you would do with that extra land that has that pump and that tank on it. What would you put there? An extra bedroom? A little garden? Some place for the children to play? Imagine that. Imagine it and then make it a reality. Imagine that the fire station in your constituency and all the fire stations in your constituency are the responsibility of the supervisor of public security in your constituency and that there are ambulances and fire service appliances within those stations laid out in correct radiuses from all of the citizens in the constituencies that in an emergency, paramedic operated ambulances could report to your house in 15 minutes or less, that could get to the hospital and open the back and pull out the stretcher and head to the ER and another stretcher from the last time they were there, put back in the ambulance, and that people who were set up to deal with whatever ailment you have were expecting you because they were told all along the drive when the ambulance was coming, so they rush you straight into casualty, treated you, and either put you in the hospital or discharge you. Imagine that country. Imagine a country where you go to the grocery and you can shop because you worked for the month and you got paid for the month and the basics, you could afford the basics. You could feed your family. The rent could pay, the lights could pay, the water could pay, and you could feed your family. And you don't have to work two jobs. You don't have to work two jobs. So you could spend some of the time allotted to you in this life with your children. Because there are some of you, I talked to a security guard tonight. And the man is so intelligent, he's so brilliant, he's so well-spoken. And he's a security guard. And he's saying to me, boss, what do you have in your plans for me? I work two jobs to feed my children. I had to explain to the man the concept of the value of a unit of work and the cost of living. And that it is the government's job to bring the two of them together until people who are even minimum wage could have a life in this country and not be suffering and hustling every day just to keep up with yesterday. It is time. It is way past time. I'll tell you all something. I sat in a meeting of all the small parties because they've been harassing me. So myself, the chairman Felicia Holder, head of PEP Media, Satish Ramsaran, who's an executive member, and deputy political leader Anthony Defoe, went to hear what exactly their plan was. Only to find out that we were correct, that they really have no plan. They have none. And what they want is to try and gang up and say, look we, and give the media something new to stand for. And we had to say, in that meeting, that country first means something. That you can't just slap different people together without knowing what their ideologies are, what they stand for, what they stand against. You can't create something without knowing what you're building with. And we in the Progressive Empowerment Party cannot, in good conscience, after working as hard as we've worked for the past 3 years and change, every day, we work every day. I was just in two meetings. Felicia Hola's chairman joined me in those meetings. She'll be there tomorrow organizing all the things that take place in the finance, while Satish Ramsaran organizes Pep Media in the morning, and Anthony Defu is having his show tomorrow. These people, Sean Sunarine, coordinating the party organization with Michelle Davis, Glenn Robinson, Shari Wilson, working nonstop. This party did not get here waiting for a maxi to stop and jump on board. We started off with plans. The Progressive Empowerment Party started off by releasing a 21-point brochure of sneak peek policies that changed the national conversation. That's not our entire manifesto. Our entire manifesto has crossed 100 items, and I talk some of them that the members here are not on the sneak peek, but the people who read the sneak peek of our policies. We launched with home ownership for all, national security, established radar-connected security platforms 3 miles out at sea to create a virtual wall around Trinidad and Tobago manned by law enforcement professionals and equipped with fast attack boats and interceptor helicopter gunships that would enforce stop and search for all marine craft entering our waters. This will bring an end to the illegal trade in guns, drugs, and human cargo. That's a paragraph. That paragraph is the job description of the Minister of National Security. And we don't do it. The country is mismanaged. First world law enforcement, engage the services of foreign law enforcement, international internal affairs and investigative teams to clean up the police service of corruption and criminal activity. Establish continuous training and assessment inclusive of mandatory drug and polygraph testing. Incentivize law enforcement through bonuses and rewards for exemplary service. Establish promotion policy based on merit and instructed by knowledge and skill development, as well as unblemished records. Come on. That's a map. From criminals to contributing citizens. Those who run afoul of the law and end up in jail will be given the tools to return to society better equipped than when they entered. Mandatory literacy, therapeutic counseling, and conflict resolution skills, together with opportunities to learn trades and even attain university degrees, would be offered to encourage personal development and provide hope and opportunity away from a life of crime. Come on! James Scott, everybody just saw you ask that question on this thread, and members will be emailing you that in the soonest possible time. Number 5, first world healthcare. Build and operate 41 constituency healthcare facilities complete with accident and emergency minor surgery services that would put healthcare within easy reach of all citizens 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Deploy professionally trained call center control, paramedic, ambulance service to fire stations, health centers, and police stations to allow for emergency responses in under 10 minutes nationwide. Monitor fleet via GPS. Number 6, prestige education for all. Abolish the abusive SEA. Make all schools 10-year zone schools. Establish a grade point average system that monitors the performance of students, teachers, and principals simultaneously. Create constituency education board of supervisors to monitor it all. Every term, the performance of every child will be tracked, and those falling behind, we will be able to identify and find out what the obstacles to their learning is and intervene. 8, 7, higher education and skills training. Make education finance available that can be repaid either as loans or through public service in disciplines deemed essential to national development. Establish assessment facilities for skills and trade certification. Develop a national trades and skills master plan to guide career choices. You see that one? Establish assessment facility for skills and trade certification. There are hairdressers, mechanics, carpenters, masons. There are people in all manner of trades, chefs, cooks, seamstress, tailors, that don't know their level of capacity. So they don't know if they're charging the correct price. So you could be actually benefiting. Every now and then somebody will tell you, hey, I'm going to send you a carpenter or electrician. He real good and he real cheap. And the reason he real good is because he's worked hard at it his whole life. But the reason he is real cheap is that he doesn't know. And nobody has certified him to call him a master electrician. There are welders who are 2 certificates away from being a master welder. So right now you're paying them $200 an hour when they deserve $2,000 an hour. We need to establish places for people to go and say, listen, I've been an apprentice my entire life. I've worked as a carpenter, a mason. I've worked as an electrician, a plumber. I've worked as a cook, a chef, a seamstress. I've worked as a tailor. I'm a hairdresser. Show me what you know. Demonstrate to me your skill sets and I will certify you, or I will tell you what you need to learn to be able to be certified. Food independence. Set food targets based on national consumption data. Make farmland available rent-free to small farmers. Set crop schedules. Purchase, harvest, and distribute produce through 41 constituency wholesale and retail markets. By setting up constituency wholesale markets and retail markets, you put the farmer's food in the hands of the seller without all the different levels of markups that take the price of food beyond the affordability level. We need people to be able to get a breadfruit need to be $5. Avocado not supposed to cross $5. Mango supposed to be $4 for $5. Pomsite, guava. We need to get our food prices back down there. Kale that is selling price mark for $45 grows and retails in Trinidad for $3. $3. The difference between $45 and $3 is how much? 1,000%. We need to get back. We need to get to a place where people can afford to live. Policy 9, Tobago and Trinidad. Written that way because it's policy number 9. Until an actual bridge could be built, we must work to ensure that all goods and services that are available in Trinidad are also available in Tobago at the same prices, and that movement between both islands is uncomplicated and affordable. Establish within the sister isle opportunities for further education in tourism and agriculture, and create credit facilities that support the development of these and other industries. 10. Alternative renewable energy. I'm reading this because we launched this party with this. The Progressive Empowerment Party came out the gate saying this is what we will do. Number 10, alternative renewable energy. Develop alternatives to oil and gas, encourage wind farms, solar arrays, and tidal generators used to provide cheap, abundant, and clean energy for all. Let me expand that for you. Trinidad and Tobago could be a regional leader in the provision of cheap alternative renewable energy, and we could supply it to all of our neighbors at very low cost. Number 11, clean, reliable, pipe-borne water for all. Decentralized water management and distribution to all 41 constituencies through the establishment of constituency-owned and operated water purification and distribution plants responsible for sourcing their own supply through bulk transmission, wells, rainwater, retention dams and ponds, or desalination. This plan would quickly allow all citizens to benefit from a reliable, clean source of water 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Number 12, a war on poverty. Make universal home ownership a reality and job creation a top priority. Encourage foreign direct investment in labor-intensive business partnerships. Set medium-term national jobs for all master plan that leaves no citizen behind. Establish living wage policy to guide the minimum wage. There's a lot in that paragraph. Make universal home ownership a reality and job creation a top priority. The Progressive Empowerment Party says anybody who wants a job should have one, and anybody who has a job that wants to own a home should be able to. Encourage foreign direct investment in labor-intensive business partnerships. This was the India model. This moved India in 30 years from being the slums of the world to having the largest middle class on planet Earth. set medium-term national jobs for all master plan that leaves no citizen behind. Establish living wage policy to guide minimum wage. All the key economic indicators, all the things that you have to spend money on, transport, food, lights, phone, rent, mortgage, all of those things are to be put together and tracked to make sure that the minimum wage could afford to keep up with the cost of living. So you create something called a living wage that pegs the minimum wage to the cost of these key items. And it will instruct the government to raise minimum wage or lower the cost of these items to keep that gap closed. A war on poverty. No, number 13, regulate the financial sector. Interest to be paid on depositors' funds at rates set by central bank. Abolish all banking fees not compliant with terms of banking license. Open the banking sector to international competition. Cap the spread on foreign exchange. The difference between the prices for buying and selling foreign exchange, the spread, puts an unnecessary 13% tax on the economy. Capping it to under 3% would save billions of dollars lost to artificial inflation and profiteering. Nothing eats away at the average person's salary like the cost of doing business with a bank. And that, more than anything, needs to fix. Opening the market to international competition will drive all the cost of services down, increase values paid to customers, and create a better environment for everybody. 14, from employee to employer. Startup support for small businesses with demonstrated potential for success. Operational credit to assist with recurring expenditures of rent, electricity, and raw materials for approved projects monitored by dedicated case officers and designed to achieve profitability in quick time. Talk to you about that fast. Our natural gas is free. We're supposed to be able to provide electricity to our people free, and we could provide it to our small business development farms. We could create places where that type of industry could be supported through electricity, rent. 3 years, we said that is the time it takes to take a business from the idea stage to success. We will assist you with raw materials. If the business that you are in makes a 16, 17, 18% profit on cost minus materials, we will give you a recurring overdraft to cover the cost of your raw materials that you must invest to defend with profit. In 3 years, you have no rent to pay, no lights to pay, no internet to pay, no phone to pay. So all you have to do is operate your business. We will give you the overdraft credit facility to turn over. That means cash in, cash out. Every time you get paid, you pay back. And as your net profit resources grow, you will be able to increase your own production until at some point you no longer need access to credit. Your case officer that will be working with you, that will guarantee that payment, that overdraft, every single time you produce and you sell, all of that information has to be made available to your caseworker. And your caseworker will be guiding you as to how to increase your profits and how to invest back in yourself, and we'll get somewhere. 15, public office reform. Make all public office holders accountable. Enact recall and termination legislation for instances of non-performance and misconduct in public affairs. We also say we want to give the Integrity Commission teeth. The Integrity Commission right now could just provide a list to the Director of Public Prosecutions and say these people are not compliant. And whether DPP chooses to act or not is entirely up to the DPP. But we want to make the Speaker of the House an elected position, and the Integrity Commission can supply to the Speaker of the House and say these members of the House are not compliant with the terms of the Integrity in Public Life Act, so that they are barred from the House of Representatives. Imagine the impact on that on the politics. 16, electoral reform. cap election spending that disqualifies candidates for breaches. Basically, if you're allowed to spend $100,000 for the campaign, you spend $101,000, your candidate is disqualified. And that equal opportunity media law. What that means is, anybody that you give media time to, you have to give all the candidates the same media time. When Arnold Schwarzenegger was running for governor of California, the Federal Communications Commission wrote all of the companies, all the TV companies, cable companies, and said, you cannot broadcast any of his movies, because if you broadcast any of his movies during the electoral period, you will have to give all of his opponents equal time. Remove the $5,000 deposit currently required to contest an election. Candidates must reside within the constituency they hope to represent. 17, an end to corruption. Shut down all special purpose companies and establish robust and transparent tenders process that disconnects purchase decision and contractual awards away from the political directorate. Sell non-essential state companies. When you, as a minister, say you want to buy 100 fire trucks, you should not know, and you should not be in the process of how that contract for 100 fire trucks is awarded. Somebody completely disconnected from your ministry must make that decision based on terms and conditions set by the technocrats of you, the buyer, and sent by the sellers. 18, no more mega contractors. Decentralize all public developmental and maintenance work to constituencies, with all contractors and employees having to reside within the constituency where projects are located. 19. The first time Trinidad and Tobago heard decriminalized marijuana, it was from the Progressive Empowerment Party. Decriminalized marijuana. Medicinal marijuana is now the number one cash crop in California and other jurisdictions. Grown for export to the global pharmaceutical industry could create massive revenue streams and much needed jobs. Regulated and controlled the way tobacco and alcohol are would allow for much needed protection and controls and remove the criminal underworld from the equation. 20. National plastic bottles policy. Apply tax to plastic bottles at manufacture or importation stage. Redeem tax for return of discarded bottles so as to encourage environmental cleanup. Provide a ready stock of material for road building and construction industries and generate revenue for those least employable and most in need. 21. First world development. Establish new city within easy access from all corners of Trinidad and Tobago for offices of state currently based in Port of Spain. Implement online and ATM payments wherever possible for ease of payment and decentralization of transactions. Properly done, this would end the hours lost to traffic faced by state employees twice daily and put essential services within easy reach of all. The Progressive Empowerment Party is the only political party in this country's history that came out the gates with a manifesto like that, that dealt with everybody. So that some people could be writing, what about this industry and what about that industry? And everything will find its way to fit itself into that. But we have a plan. We have a plan. We are guided by the fact that government's job is the management of the human condition. We propose something called the happiness index, the quality of life index. We propose to put up a web portal available to all the people of Trinidad and Tobago that asks one question: are you happy? If not, why not? And you have opportunities to go through and tick and say and why and what. And the algorithms, the data that you enter will be compiled with all other data, and we'll be able to wake up every morning and look at the happiness index and see, Trinidad is 89% happy, I think that's good. 90% happy, great. Trinidad is 71% happy, there was a drop. What is the drop? And you go and you look at all of the key indicators: national security, traffic, crime, cost of living, jobs, whatever it is. And people would have the data that people individually would have entered would give you a collective number. And you'd be able to tell the Minister of National Security, look, 82% of the unhappy people are unhappy because of crime. You are failing. Address that. We're monitoring that every day now. Bring that number down. So you run a country, especially a country small like this. I had to explain to somebody today how shipping works. You ship a container from Trinidad to Australia. It goes on a ship in Trinidad's port and goes to Miami. It comes off the ship in Miami and that ship goes. And next ship picks up that container and takes it to the UK. and leaves it in the UK and goes. And next ship picks it up in the UK and takes it to Australia. And that's how global shipping works. Why is Trinidad and Tobago not one of those hubs where people dropping off their containers? That is what Singapore and Dubai make money on. Shipping. Billions of dollars. Singapore's GDP is $322 billion a year. We's 22. They're half the size. They are 5 million people. They are first world developed country. We are a rat hole, a narco state, and a failed nation. Ask yourself, if you cannot find a single thing in this country that you could say works as it should, who do you blame? The trolls on Facebook? The activists raising issues? The people who dare to tell you that your government is doing a crocus bag of shit? Who do you blame? If the maxi veering all over the road, do you want to shout at the man who calling from the back to ask the driver if he okay? Or are you asking the driver, boss, what's going on in front there? We the people of Trinidad and Tobago, we've been mismanaged, misled. We've been taken for a ride. It is way past time that we got together as one people under one flag, ignored issues like race and class and skin color and hair texture and who you're praying to and who you're lying down with at night. Those things don't matter to the water in your tap. It don't matter to the value of the money in your pocket. It doesn't matter to the cost of the food in the grocery. It doesn't matter to if you have a job or could own a home. The things that matter is the quality of representation and leadership you get from the government. I tell you this without fear of contradiction. We've been failed by every single government. Not one person could explain to me where our money went. We're supposed to have $3 trillion tucked away in the Heritage and Stabilization Fund for a rainy day. We have zero. We have less than nothing, and we owe the world. This country is broken by deliberate design. Those who have benefited from it continue to fund politicians to give them control of your treasury, while those you've elected to office to represent you take you for a ride. Today, Stuart Young fell off that stage symbolically. And I hope the rest of them, especially people like Fitzgerald Hines, who think a little dose of water from a constituent vexed with you is a reason for you to have them arrested and taken before the courts. People like y'all who are living so high up are disconnected from the wills, from the realities that the people on the ground are facing. Don't wait for God to give you your tumble. Wake up. But I want to say, it's an election year, so I'm expecting you all to try and stunt a little bit. Based on just the mismanagement of crime in this country and the laws that Faris Al-Rawi have tried to write, citing crime as the reason, based just on that, I tell Trinidad and Tobago, this PNM government, putting them back in office, is a risk of epic proportion. I would describe them as completely dangerous. And it is time, it is way past time that we stood together as one people under one flag. And on Saturday, March 21st at 5 p.m., the process begins of reinventing Trinidad. And we invite all of one.
Your vote will decide.
right there because we've been on for long, and I want to say to all of you who stand firm, listen, there are a couple of rats outside there that their whole mission is to continue to attack because they can't do what we do, so they attack. What are you going to do? Comes with the territory. The Progressive Empowerment Party is growing exponentially. There is already the acknowledgement, despite what the 1% owned and operated media would have you believe, there's already on the ground the general idea that there are only three parties in the country to contest the election, PNM, UNC, and PEP. And it is quickly becoming the norm that people are believing that the only solution among all of them is the Progressive Empowerment Party. SABGA, hear me well! Hear me well, Mr. SABGA. Starting on March 21st, we put our people on the ground. All of our communicating will be done door to door. We will be ringing doorbells and we will be knocking on doors and going to the people and taking the message of hope to them directly. So you can block us from your, whatever they call your media now. You can block us, no problem. The game is over. And I promise you this, there will be an accounting in the future. A Progressive Empowerment Party government will slash all that government advertising that upholding your failed enterprise. Keep it up, brother. Keep it all the way up. The game is about to change. We are launching 10 candidates on the 21st of March. 4 weeks later, we launch 10 more. In quick time, we will have our 41 candidates on the ground working as shadow MPs in their constituencies, changing the way representation is done. Trinidad and Tobago, it is your responsibility to rescue this country. It is mine. It is ours together. This division, this racism, this nonsense, end it now. Make this country powerful. Take Trinidad and Tobago to where it was meant to be. Paradise on earth convincingly, to quote David Rudder. If you want a better Trinidad and Tobago, you are going to have to stand together to make it happen. And we have put everything in place. You could never say you didn't know. And you could never say we didn't try. If you want it, show up to make it happen. Until tomorrow, stay safe, Trinidad and Tobago.